Hello and welcome everyone. I am Raman. I work for an organization called WaterAid India, and my specific area of work is on WASH policies, water and sanitation hygiene policies, and their integration to various development as well as health related issues. So my job today is to moderate this session. I'm very glad to do this, and I welcome all of you and my esteemed panelists. You might be aware that WaterAid is a not-for-profit organization. It is working for water and sanitation and hygiene at the community level in close coordination with governments at various levels. And today and tomorrow and day after, when this Charcha 2020 is happening, one of the 16 channels of the Charcha 2020 is on water sanitation and hygiene. And WaterAid is hosting this, and we thank the Nudge Foundation for giving WaterAid this opportunity. And this session is the first amongst the five key sessions and, you know, some other sessions in this series. And I'm very happy to open up this discussion here. So I don't need to say that COVID has opened up a range of challenges in front of us. And you know, without killing a large number of people, what COVID has done is it killed the overconfidence with which the humankind and some specific nations were operating on various fronts, including health. And during the early days of COVID, I remember there was a cartoon, and this cartoon was, you know, depicting the what you call Spanish flu and some of the other viruses, and the COVID virus, the novel coronavirus, was speaking in that in a restaurant or so. All these viruses were sitting, and the COVID virus was telling that my vision is not to kill people per se, but to raise awareness about public health. So, I mean, it is very important, although it was written in a very jovial way, it's very important that the COVID, the novel coronavirus and the COVID-19 has actually taught us a lot of very important public health lessons. The number in terms of spread, in terms of the pandemic nature of this, the number of deaths may not be very high. But, you know, the kind of importance of the public health systems, primary health care and all that this has put up is actually very important. So this is very important to realize. So what the COVID so far done is also to emphasize more and more critical calls about the need of comprehensive primary health care and health for all. And this has several ingredients. Washing health facilities, healthcare facilities, you know, that is one amongst these critical ingredients. And it is important one, but for the specific context of this disease. Not only for this disease, even otherwise, washing healthcare facilities has a very important significance for running the infection prevention and, you know, managing various diseases and all that. So this is a very important agenda that we are talking about. We all also know that we have an overarching Indian public health standard that was designed as part of the National Health Mission some 15 years before. And that talked about many of the standards, including the WASH standards for the health facilities. Of late, some years before, we have this what you call the Kayakalp guidelines, and Kayakalp guidelines specifically was it was about how to improve some of these water sanitation hygiene and related issues in the healthcare facilities. And then we have programs like Lakshya, the labor room quality, you know, a lot of components were introduced of late into this. And as part of the Swachh Bharat mission, there was something called Swachh Swasth Sarvatra, which was focusing on our primary healthcare facilities. So now COVID has added some new challenges of water sanitation and hygiene in front of the healthcare facilities. So that could be around infection prevention, that could infection prevention protocols. That could be around the proper management and disposal of the biomedical waste. And these all are seen as the first line of defense for the COVID. And this is all for both healthcare providers, workers, and also for the patients and people and support staff. So in this context, our panelists will discuss some critical issues like key WASH challenges and needs with relation to the healthcare facilities and suggest strategic possibilities for improvement, and also identify strategies for strengthening and sustaining the critical WASH space that the pandemic has opened up. So how after the pandemic, which is going to be, I mean, as every day we are realizing that this pandemic is going to be with us for a little more time, longer time. So after the pandemic, how the Washington healthcare facilities can be sustained. So these are the questions, the key questions that we will try to address today. And we have a bunch of, panelists, and I have the best possible set of panelists for this session. So let me introduce all of them. I have Dr. Sitaram, Dr. M.R. Sitaram. He's a practicing orthopedic surgeon with the Swami Vivekananda Hospital in Bangalore. Besides that, importantly, he's also the South Asia convener of the Freshwater Action Network. We call it FANSA. So he's a doctor turned into public health, into water and sanitation. So it's a very large area of activity that and experience that he's having. Apart from that, he's also closely working with the state and district health departments in various districts of Karnataka. So we will have a micro as well as macro perspective that Dr. Sitaram will present us. And we have Dr. Jayan Srivastava. Dr. Jayan Srivastava was instrumental in setting up the Kayakalp guidelines, also the Lakshya guidelines. So he is the advisor to the National Health System Resource Center, which is the apex body, the technical hand of the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. So he is a senior advisor looking after quality of healthcare in the NHSRC. And since he has been instrumental in setting up these things, so we have the primary opportunity to listen to him about some of the issues and challenges that we are facing and the possible solutions that is possible. So I welcome Dr. Sitaram and Dr. Srivastava. And we have Manjeet Saluja. Manjeet Saluja is a environmental health professional, and he is the national professional officer with the World Health Organization. So Manjeet will tell us. He was till recently he was part of the WHO CRO also. So he has exposure to various countries in the Southeast Asia region. So he'll be able to tell us about what is happening around the world and what we can learn in terms of ensuring and sustaining WASH facilities in the WASH services in the healthcare facilities. So he's the National Professional Officer with the WHO, and he is closely working with two ministries actually. Both the Health and Family Welfare Ministry and also the Water and Sanitation Ministry. So that linkages also we can get from Manjeet. And we have Pradibha Singh. Pradibha is also from another UN body, UNICEF, and she is the WASH specialist, specifically responsible for WASH and health facilities, also other integration of WASH issues with other development areas. So she is having a lot of important initiative that she has taken with both these not only with health and the water and sanitation ministry, she also worked closely with other ministries. And we have finally Asad Umar. Asad Umar is the senior program officer with the Aga Khan Development Network, Aga Khan Foundation. And Asad and his team focuses on WASH and healthcare facilities in two important states of India, both UP and Bihar, Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, the largest, both in terms of size and in terms of challenges. So they have enormous experiences to share about both these states, and also through the Aga Khan Rural Support Program, AKRSP, Asad and team also is working on many other states. So I look forward to listen to. So I welcome Manjeet, Pradibha, Asad, and Dr. Sitaram and Dr. Srivastava to this panel. And I'm very glad to welcome you all, and looking forward to have a very live discussion over the 80 minutes or so that we will have left with us. And my colleagues from both the Nudge Foundation and WaterAid India are here, and I welcome all of them. And they'll be helping us in putting together all the various questions that are coming from the audience and the discussions and all that. So I thank all of them, and I welcome all of them to this group. And I finally welcome all the various people who have joined us for this very important session. and I welcome all of you and would like to initiate the discussion. So let me initiate the discussion with an overarching question for all of you. So I can, you know, the order can be, you know, I was expecting because of Dr. Jayan Srivastava had a, you know, very important meeting at the ministry to finish. So he had told me that he may be a little late. So I was keeping him second, but now I can start with him. So it will be in the order of Dr. Srivastava, Dr. Sitaram, and Manjeet, and Pradibha, and Asad. That will be the order of, you know, responses. But the question, first question is common for everyone. We all know that WASH facilities in, WASH in healthcare facilities in India has several gaps, numerous gaps. We know that, you know, we are in a very challenging situation and COVID has really exposed us and COVID has really added to our challenges. So in your opinion, how this pandemic has underscored the intensified need to address and improve the WASH services in the healthcare facilities. May I request Dr. Srivastava to start with? Dr. Srivastava, over to you.
In fact, thank you, Raman and colleagues. And at the outset, in fact, I am grateful to WaterAid, Nudge Foundation, and the colleagues over there for having taken this initiative to arrange this charcha spread over a period of 3 days, and also having an important session on WASH in health facilities, which is very dear to, in fact, all of us who have joined or who are the panelists. So in fact, conventionally, it was seen that Indian public health system per se, and in term of more so when we talk functionality at the community health center level, PHC level, lower down with the health and wellness center coming up, that in term of having the WASH facilities, they would be grossly underprepared. And but when I, in fact, Raman did mention about the Kayakalp initiative, and those of you who are relatively new to this term, Kayakalp initiative got launched somewhere in fact, 2015, initially for the district hospital, later on the community health centers, sub-district hospitals, primary health centers, and in the current, in fact, last year, this health and wellness center component got added. So in that context, in fact, the primary objective was the same, in fact, without having any political biases. But when the government launched this Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, we thought that at NHSRC, let's do something for our public health facilities. And in that context, it was launched. And why I'm emphasizing on Kayakalp, that, I mean, nobody would have liked that a pandemic of magnitude of COVID hitting, but at same time, certain amount of the preparedness, I mean, the facilities, the ground situation, Manjeet will bear me out because the WHO has been validating and collecting that data, that those 4 or 5 core elements of WASH, the facilities had been prepared in a fairly good shape. Today morning, when I looked at the data, that about 90% of the facilities, they had the, at least at district hospital level, they had the good quality of the water, availability, and alcohol, even as simple as that, alcohol-based rub, it had been there. But when this pandemic, in fact, hit us sometime in the month of February, end or March, first and foremost, in fact, the thing which came out very manifest was there had been a kind of fear of unknown, that in what shape it will hit. And in that context, in fact, government started multiple strategies. One had been that, helping those states where there had not been enough technical support in terms of having the guidelines, looking at the available guidelines, helping the states. And few of us would recall that, in fact, since I mean the scope and the complete dimension of this pandemic had been so much and varied and ever evolving, that guidelines have been also undergoing a revision. And for a simple thing that we will discuss during whatever time permits, that even as simple as that biomedical waste management, it had been evolving and new guidelines the government has been coming out. But the key gap which came out, other than the fear of unknown, had been that formulating these guidelines had been fine, but all of us are aware about the diversity and the range of the Indian system, that how does it work and how much time does it take. So at times we noticed that there had been a gap in reaching the accurate information, number one. Then that financial allocations, the state had been given the liberty that every district can use up to 1 crore rupees or the 20% of the central allocation. And total this thing has been left to the different districts. How do they want to utilize this money in that context? And third major initiatives had been creating the enabling policy environment, so that, I mean, the faster procurement, faster inductions, and other thing takes place. So it took some time for the system to move on, and perhaps this lockdown had given that kind of, in fact, time space in preparing the health facilities, and same thing stands true for the wash, strengthening the wash. Lastly, I would like to mention that initially we do realize, that is my personal opinion, that initially the focus was in equipping with, say, tertiary care equipment-like thing or that skills. As simple as that focus being on the ventilator. While the statistics tells us that about 1.2 to 1.54% only, 4% of the admitted patients, they need the ventilator. So now, in fact, the attention is being given to the other dimensions. So this is the overall view, Raman. Any specific point, then I can cover later.
Thank you. I'll come back to you. So may now... request Dr. Sitaram about this very quickly, not in very detail, to give an overview of this specific question about how has the pandemic underscored the intensified need of wash. Dr. Sitaram, over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Raman. Am I audible?
Yeah, you are.
Yeah. Thank you, Ms. Raman. Thank you, WaterAid and the Nudge Foundation. And good evening to all the co-panelists and the people who are tuning in. So as a opening remark, you rightly said that this is rather unprecedented times, totally unknown, uncharted seas. So we are moving ahead, and the progress has been at times very, very dismal, but at the same time, like Dr. Srivatsa was saying, there are some good things also that are coming out. But coming specifically to the point that you raised, WASH and healthcare facilities. Now, I'd like to look at these two. WASH, conventionally, we had generally focused on WASH infrastructure, in the sense water supply, water quality, water dispensing, etc. And in terms of sanitation, we had generally looked at maybe the toilets, the human excreta management, waste management. You know, these were the bigger things. And in general, hygiene had been a poor cousin. The practice of safe sanitation, the practices that keep safe water safe or a safe disinfectant safe, in the hospital setting, probably had not been given adequate focus. Now it is bringing us back to the point that what actually allows the virus inside is how you deal with it and what you do, what you practice. So it is bringing a whole lot of new focus on hygiene, and it is not just about hand washing. It's also about distancing. It's also about cough hygiene, food hygiene, you know, so many other dimensions that seem to be opening up beyond just water quality or toilet construction. In healthcare facility infrastructure, the focus again related to WASH was based on what water and sanitation directly required. But now we are talking a whole lot of issues around patient crowding, about patient movement, patient circle, people circulation, and the volume of place or space that that a person is expected to be provided. So now we are forced to look at a scenario where the hospital architecture or the hospital infrastructure itself has to be WASH compliant, has to be hygiene compliant, and made sure that every person entering will have a safe zone. And in our diverse situation, where a healthcare facility need not be a state-of-the-art tertiary care center, it can well be a single-room clinic where hundreds of people throng in rural areas. Given this diversity and inequity, the challenge that it has now opened up is, how do we bring about better standardization? How do we bring about overall infrastructural safety for sanitation and hygiene, in addition to just supplying safe water?
Thank you. Manjeet, can I now request you to come in with your thoughts on this? Very quick.
Yeah. Thanks, Raman. I hope I'm audible.
You are.
Yeah. Please go ahead. So thank you for this opportunity. And certainly it's an honor to be a part of this very important panel and with this, such a kind of august panel members. But quickly coming to the question. So as I think you have already set the context that WASH in healthcare facilities is kind of very critical in many health areas, including safe and resilient kind of health systems. We are talking about maternal, newborn and child health, infection prevention, control, and even antimicrobial resistance. And just the other day, I was reading as well that improved everyday hygiene practices, such as hand washing, reduces the risk of common infections by up to 50% and reduces the need for antibiotics by up to 30%, which is a huge figure. So WASH plays certainly a important role in all these things. So it's certainly a fundamental component for the universal health cover, which is an important pillar in the WHO's work and underpins certainly the delivery of safe, quality health services for all, especially women and girls. And I think it's very important to focus out there on the gender component as well. So the need certainly becomes much more important during all these infectious disease outbreaks, including the COVID-19. And ensuring these evidence-based and consistently applied WASH and waste management practices in healthcare facilities will certainly help to prevent this human-to-human transmission of the virus that causes COVID-19. But if we look only from the hygiene point of view, we are constrained certainly in the hand hygiene infrastructure at the health facilities. And then is the behavior change associated towards hand hygiene. So that two components. And healthcare facilities certainly need to work to enable more frequent and regular hand washing by access to the hand hygiene facilities and using approaches to support that good hand hygiene behavior. And it's also important, it becomes very, very important so that, we talk about the healing hands of the health workers. So they remain the healing hands and not become the carriers of fatal diseases. And that's where the whole trust factor of...
Very good way to put it up,
So that whole trust factor on the healthcare facilities comes in out there. And then comes in the area of the water disinfection and sanitation treatment, which also helps reduce the viruses. So in conclusion to this particular thing, I would only say that improving access to WASH in healthcare settings designed with gender considerations can certainly contribute to very sustainable improvements in the quality of healthcare services and support core aspects of the universal health coverage, including equity and dignity, and ultimately to the positive health and empowerment outcomes for women and their families. So that's where I will end. Over.
All right. Thanks, Pradibha. Now over to you. So this first opening question, this pandemic has underscored and intensified the need to address WASH. Can you very quickly respond and reflect on this?
Yeah, so good afternoon all participants, and thanks to WaterAid, Nudge Foundation and Charcha team for organizing this. Thanks to all the participants who have joined us. So water sanitation hygiene practices in healthcare facility have long been advocated for, and globally and India as well. Doctors, healthcare professionals, also people who are associated with the public health scenario, they have always been aware of it, and it has always been a part of medical curriculum also. But somehow there was a nonchalant or a kind of sense of confidence about a health facility in people and also healthcare professional. And somewhere, first things used to come first. And the objective of saving lives, responding to medical emergencies, somewhere it used to take priority over water sanitation hygiene, the facilities per se, and also hygiene behavior. And also given the kind of resource crunch that our country has been having for so long, it was not possible over these years to focus, give the required amount of focus on maintaining safe water, hygienic practices, and adequate and gender separated sanitation facilities in the healthcare center. Somehow with the COVID-19 and the entire aspect of infection prevention about containing this disease, so somewhere the importance has been highly, I would say, it has been brought to the forefront, and everybody, I would say, right from common people to technical people, academicians, healthcare professionals, everybody is like now gearing up in this direction. So in the coming time, after maybe the surge of COVID-19 has gone away, or maybe we have found a good remedy, a good vaccine and a therapy for COVID-19. Even after that phase, since the virus is going to stay in the ecosystem for long, so I'm sure that water sanitation hygiene in healthcare facilities will get prioritized. And also what will come to light, I would say, in the coming time is the entire, like how the society also visualizes the healthcare settings. And I would say the major, the cornerstone for working on infection prevention control and water sanitation hygiene in healthcare facility is the fact that the site of treatment of disease should not end up becoming the site of transmission of diseases. So somewhere this philosophy will become more prominent as we progress.
Thanks. Thanks, Pradipa. That is, yeah. So Asad, would you like to, reflect on from how you see this specific opportunity or the kind of situation? Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Raman, for having me on this panel, and a very good evening to all participants and esteemed panelists. I think Dr. Srivastav and other panelists have set the tone. A couple of points I would definitely like to add here. As we all know, I remember at the outbreak of this pandemic, in a statement from, I suppose it was from WHO WASH chief. He's at that point of time, actually he mentioned that now it is time for the world to actually recognize WASH as a sort of public health intervention. From this perspective, I would like to put forth some of my opinions on this. No doubt, healthcare plays a critical facility, play a critical role in any outbreak response. And they're the backbone actually to countries' defense to limit or contain the spread of disease. Now, in a pandemic situation like this, what is really important is safely managed WASH services. I think Dr. Sitaraman has emphasized on this. When we say safely managed WASH services, so it also includes the whole behavior components in healthcare facilities. To deliver, one, quality health services, protect patient, what Pratibha has mentioned here, and health workers and staff. During current situation, infection and control protocols assume a greater importance, as these are spaces, those are going to be of high footfall zones. And when facilities lack basic WASH access, the public, especially women, they may avoid or delay in health-seeking care. Now, if you just look at the current protocol of this pandemic, this also requires for the patients to stay back in facilities, and that is where actually WASH assumes a greater importance.
All right.
So in this regard, I think this pandemic has actually opened up a sort of the whole discussion and the priorities around WASH access within healthcare facilities, and this is the right time to improve WASH in healthcare facilities, not just as an immediate response to COVID, but largely as a response towards improved patient outcome.
Thanks. Thanks. So I'm not going to leave you here because, the next set of questions, I'm going in the reverse order so that I'll end with Dr. Srivastava here. So my question, specific questions I'm charting now, the specific question to you is that Asad, Aga Khan Foundation has been very proactively conducting research on Washington healthcare facilities over the last year and the previous year. I have been seeing some of the critical kind of insights that Aga Khan Foundation was bringing in, both in UP and some of the districts of UP and some of the districts of Bihar. So there are very critical insights, you know, you have brought in, probably, which is very important also to, you know, understand the healthcare administrators and the service providers to understand where are they standing and what all are the areas that they can look at. So that is one question to you. And also, I know that, you know, you have been supporting hand hygiene facilities in the healthcare facilities during this pandemic situation. Also, you are trying to guide biomedical waste management in some of the facilities. So how things are happening now? And then you can also please outline how WASH sector organizations and health sector organizations can together take action to improve WASH in healthcare facility, especially in the resource constrained settings, like both in terms of money and also in terms of health systems. We have UP, Bihar, and similar many other states. So how, you know, in the resource constrained settings, the WASH facilities can be improved, as your experience go.
Thank you, Raman. I would start from what Dr. Srivastava has mentioned, that we do have good policies in place, but when it comes to its actual implementation and grounds, sometimes things actually don't go the way we want it to go. Now, with as you rightly mentioned, that Aga Khan Foundation, I mean, Pritha is sitting here, so we are actually in UP, we are partnering with UNICEF, and that has given us an opportunity to closely work with the system to bring an improvement in the facilities. So it is not only about undertaking certain assessment or research activity, but also sitting with the district government, working on it and trying to bring in certain improvement. Now, we have been working in partnership with UNICEF for 1.5 years, and a comprehensive tracking tool. We have used almost 13 key parameters, including access to and functionality of WASH services and behavior and practices of service provider. And this is based on, as Dr. Srivastava has outlined in his opening remark, Government of India's Labor Room Quality Improvement Guidelines, the Lakshya, National Quality Assurance Standard, and also WHO's WASH Fit tools. Now, data, what we did actually, the data related to WASH parameters, it was around water access, hand washing facilities, then toilet access, then waste segregation and overall cleanliness. We're tracked from, actually we focus on three patient care points, that is NBCC, labor room and PNC ward. This assessment actually helped us to identify facilities which were deemed functional, non-functional or partially functional, because that was something where, in fact, district government were not having any idea. And that has actually given us certain insights into it. Now, based on this, the status was then shared with district health society meetings. And I'm going a little into detail of what exactly we did on the ground, because it will be useful for the larger audience.
It will be useful if, you know, that can be linked with the current COVID situation, how these recommendations be used elsewhere.
I'm coming to that. So a status was shared with district health society meeting and also with MOIC, and that has helped to actually develop a sort of incremental plan for improvement of these facilities. The engagement of district and has helped to increase allocation of untied funds, the Rogi Kalyan Samiti funds, because somehow it was also critical at district level to actually sit with them and have a discussion, and then focus on certain funding that can be utilized for the improvement of facilities. That has resulted actually, Raman, to be very honest, in fact, that has resulted into overall improvement in facilities. Just give me a second, So the status was shared, and that has resulted, for instance, in the improvement in provisioning of soap, the elbow taps, the refurbishment of toilet within PNC and labor rooms, provision of running water, and even color-coded bins across all districts. Because somewhere waste management was also a priority, especially during COVID. So safe management of waste that has assumed a sort of greater significance, and that is where we thought that this is something that should be prioritized, and accordingly we managed to bring in those improvement with the district. So this is something that we could manage to do across all districts of Uttar Pradesh. Now we are further expanding this operation in Bihar, and already we have actually demonstrated certain COVID compliant wash facilities within healthcare centers. So that we have COVID already compliant. Done.
Okay.
Yeah. COVID compliant wash facilities in healthcare centers. Now, your question around that what organizations like us can do in a situation like this. So, a couple of things I would like to highlight here. As we all know, data becomes extremely critical at this stage. Agencies such as ours can help with undertaking a rapid assessment of WASH in healthcare facilities. They can play a very, very critical role. And then working with district to bring in improvement in the WASH access. Now, this is something where actually, even during lockdown situation, we could manage to actually work with district government. We could manage to, and thanks to district collectors in almost 3 to 4 districts, they came to our support. Our team in-house, we designed certain foot-operated hand washing station. But it was really a challenging task for us to actually fabricate those facilities. Then with the help of district magistrate, actually we could manage to do that. And now across 3 to 4 districts, almost 8 facilities has already been installed, foot operated, and those are functional facilities. So this is what we call a sort of COVID compliant hand washing units. So because that minimizes the infection through hands.
Right.
Within those centers. So we can always play those important roles. And we can also help in analyzing major gaps and highlighting those to the districts. For instance, I would again cite one of our study. Our data reveals that a clear hierarchy of issues in terms of WASH, access to WASH services within healthcare facilities. For example, what we found in our survey that postnatal care wards appears to be in the worst condition across district healthcare facilities, across all districts. Then labor rooms tend to be the best. They were slightly in better conditions. Then again, if you just look at other areas, then I think it was slightly more or less. It was okay. So this particular aspect, I mean, access of WASH facilities at labor room at postnatal care and PNC. So that has given an insight that where actually district actually need to invest their money. So those insights were quite useful for the districts to prioritize their investment. Another critical aspect is to not only prevent the status, but also to present the status, I mean, to the district, but also to map it against the standard norms of guidelines, what Dr. Srivastava has mentioned, such as those within the Kayakalp and Lakshya guideline to help the district to visualize the response and what quick improvement can be undertaken. The districts to identify different sources of funds which could be used for such an improvement. I mean, this was a quite satisfying experience for us, closely working with UNICEF, working with the district. And what we have seen that if you closely engage with the district system, one can always bring in the improvement, even in a situation like COVID. So, responses, you will be surprised to understand that the responses across the district, we usually work in the Tarai zone of Uttar Pradesh, is quite swift to bring in the improvement in hand washing facilities, to provide the masks, to other protective equipment. So we could manage to see a lot of improvement in the, where you actually enter the process, you directly engage with the districts, you directly facilitate the processes. So agencies like us definitely can engage and help a lot to bring in the improvement.
All right. Thanks, yeah. Asad. I'll come back with some more questions in the next round. So, Pradibha, over to you with a specific set of questions now, which is, you know, UNICEF has been focusing for overall in across country, several states, UNICEF has been focusing on infection prevention and control protocols. So this has, whether it is guidelines, whether it is kind of, specific actions, whether it is technical support. So UNICEF has been instrumental in pushing this, over the last at least some years, this is happening. And specifically, how to do this in healthcare settings, which are deeply affected by poor water services. So that is how, UNICEF looked at it. So how, UNICEF strengthened the IPC could have, important learnings for COVID and post-COVID, I think. So Pradeepa, if you can reflect on this.
Sure.
What additional measures would you recommend at this specific time of pandemic? Yeah.
Sure.
Over to you, Pradeepa. Simon.
So, UNICEF, as you said, like we have been actively working on water sanitation hygiene in healthcare facilities since 2013. And our work in this sector started with the reproductive and maternal adolescent health, the call to action. This was launched in the year 2013. So, 2013 onwards, through the bottleneck analysis, we have been working on WASHIN healthcare facility, and our programs have been coinciding with the Government of India programs, because UNICEF.
Adibha, your slides are put up now. You can.
Sure. So my first slide is on how the WASHIN healthcare program, which includes the infection prevention and control very closely, how it has been evolving over the years. So in 2015, India launched the Kayakalp program, as Dr. Srivastava mentioned, and NHSRC and Dr. Srivastava were very closely associated with development of the Kayakalp award for the healthcare facilities. The whole program for water sanitation in healthcare facility was envisaged as a part of the mission for Clean India. Because 2015 year was a historical year for the water sanitation hygiene sector since the Clean India mission was launched. Right. And Kayakalp is a very comprehensive tool. It has like more than 200 indicators, and nearly 75% of the indicators are very much intrinsically related to water sanitation hygiene. And in 2015 itself, to accompany the Kayakalp award scheme, Swachhata guidelines for healthcare facilities were also prepared by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, and these were actively disseminated to the states, and very detailed trainings were held at the state level. Then followed by this, in 2016, the Ministry of the Drinking Water Sanitation and Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, they realized that there was a need to build upon the gains that each ministry has been making in the Clean India mission. So Ministry of Drinking Water Sanitation said that in the villages that they were helping in making open defecation free, the healthcare facility should also become Kayakalp compliant. Kayakalp compliant means that it should adhere to the minimum standards for water sanitation and hygiene, and it must have at least 70% score in terms of these basic WASH and IPC indicators. So the Triple S guideline was launched in 2016, and in the Triple S program, the role of Ministry of Drinking Water Sanitation and Ministry of Health and Family Welfare both had a role, and Ministry of Health and Family Welfare had a role in the Triple S, in the sense that they had to ensure that in case there is a community which is still not open defecation free, or it is about to be open defecation free, the nearby health facility which has been Kayakalp awarded, like they should assist in the process of making the Gram Panchayat open defecation free. So the Triple S was launched in 2016, and in 2016 onwards, which were located in open defecation free gram panchayats near the neighboring area, so that these facilities can be supported in becoming Kayakalp compliant, and they were given a financial allocation as well to become open defecation free. After the Triple S program, in 2017, the Labor Room Strengthening Initiative, or the Lakshya program, was launched, which was closely, which it lays down a set of targets for maternal and maternal health, and safe deliveries also. So this program has a very focused component on water sanitation hygiene. There is a detailed checklist over there, and it is the importance of water sanitation hygiene for maternal health and prevention of maternal and infant mortality that has been highlighted in this program. And in 2017, again, the Vishwas guidelines were also launched for all the states. Vishwas is actually a very focused program. It is it gives a menu of activities to the Gram Panchayat for the entire year. So they have to focus 1 month of the year on a particular theme, and every other month they have to change their theme. So Vishwas focuses on initiatives to synergize water, sanitation and health initiatives, and it gives detailed theme and detailed list of activities for Gram Panchayat. Then in the year 2018, some significant changes were made to the Kayakalp initiative. Some more indicators were added. Some of the indicators were made simplified so that people can easily fill up these details at the health facility level. In 2019, the Triple S or the Swachh Swasth program was expanded to the urban areas, because earlier it was having a rural focus. Next slide, please. Can we have the next slide? So
it'll be up. It takes little time. Yeah.
Okay, fine. So the next slide I have is about how UNICEF has been supporting the entire WASH in healthcare facility program over the years. So starting from the year 2013 onwards, we have been supporting like a comprehensive assessment of WASH in the healthcare facility. Comprehensive assessment is generally done online with the help of a cell phone based tool. And it is a very participatory process, that it involves all the healthcare facility staff and also a team of resource people from UNICEF and some team of experts, maybe from NHSRC, also from the state level health resource centers, they are there. And after the comprehensive assessment of the WASH and the healthcare facility, the capacity building of healthcare staff and also engineers with the public health engineering department, that is also undertaken. Followed by assessment, resource allocation is made in terms of both human resource and also financial resources for improvement of infrastructure and facilities. And at the same time, the facility improvement planning is undertaken, which includes both a focus on the hygiene behaviors and practices. And at the same time, it includes some improvement suggestions for the infrastructure or the hardware component. And in the entire process, the supportive supervision monitoring is done for results. So the assessment checklist is used as a kind of a baseline, or it is used as a master document. And against that, the improvement of the facility keeps getting recorded, and every quarter the health facility gets assessed once more to see how the progress is getting made. So during the years 2016 to 2018, like, it was our phase two of our support for WASH in healthcare program, and from 2018 onwards the phase three has started, because 2018 happened to be the timeline for the RMNCH+A program, the reproductive, maternal, infant, newborn and adolescent healthcare program. So 2018 onwards, our focus has been expanding to beyond the high priority district. Beyond the high priority district means that earlier our focus used to be on identified districts which had a very low performance in terms of maternal and child health indicators, and slowly that focus has been going beyond to expand to the entire state. And the model of these healthcare facilities where WASH improvements have been supported over the years in terms of assessment followed by capacity building and facility improvement planning and all, that has been, like, attempts have been made to upscale it for the whole state. And now, since the COVID-19 pandemic is here, efforts are ongoing to, like, intensify those efforts. Next slide, please. So just a small depiction of how our entire program moves, and internal monitoring and review and evaluation. So entire program has a facility at the center stage, and the staff from the facility and staff from the state government health department, they are at the core of all the programming requirements. Next slide, please. In the context of COVID-19, like, UNICEF has been actively working with the WHO, and also we have been working with some partner organizations. So we helped in making the isolation ward and the quarantine center checklist at the national level. And in the 15 states where we are actively working, UNICEF has been supporting in fine-tuning and contextualizing of these checklists for assessment of preparedness of the isolation wards and the quarantine centers. Because since the COVID-19 pandemic is here, a lot of health facilities are, like, gearing up, have geared up already, and they have to become compliant to be able to respond to patients suffering with COVID-19 related infections. So assessment has been supported, and followed by that, a series of online programs, online trainings have been supported for healthcare facilities staff. And in Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Gujarat, in Chhattisgarh, also in Odisha and West Bengal, very proactively state level trainings have been ongoing on COVID-19. And now something very significant to note is that because of all the technological advancement that has happened, the training of healthcare facilities is happening in local languages, and the outreach of the Zoom platform and various other online platforms for having large meetings, that has made it possible to conduct the trainings and continue the program despite the lockdown period. Now with that, there are some key recommendations that we have for WASHIN healthcare facility given the COVID-19 context. First is that there should be a system of quicker assessment of healthcare facility, as more and more such facilities are getting used for treatment of COVID-19. I mean quicker assessment in the sense that there should be a process that within one day, maybe some technology-based platforms can be used for this purpose. And in UNICEF, we have some practical working examples. And there's a joint experience with WHO that we have in Bihar, and Aga Khan Foundation will also be soon joining hands in that. So some online tools are there. So followed by quick assessment, we can quickly come to the facility improvement planning based on the findings of assessment. Then somewhere there have to be some measures to address the HR shortfalls, because human resource gaps are one of the major hindrances in when it comes to looking after water sanitation in healthcare facilities, because it is, and given the COVID pandemic, health facility staff are already overloaded and overworked, so that they are really feeling very constrained to respond to so many additional needs. So some quick measures can be devised, like scoping in of volunteers, some CFO, CSO and NGO staff who can be quickly deployed after trainings, especially to take care of WASHIN healthcare facility, also for some community outreach activities, some behavioral change communication and all. And somewhere in the longer run, the results of assessment have to be kept utilized. They should not be that assessment was done and it is not in the public domain, because right now with the Kayakal program, the experience since 2015 has been that it is no doubt a wonderful program. It gives a lot of motivation to healthcare facility, but somewhere the data usage is a limitation when a long-term improvement of water sanitation and hygiene has to be made in these healthcare facilities. So all the data which is getting generated has to be available for the planning purposes also. And finally, a system of rewards and incentives can be thought of for the healthcare facility which have been doing marvelous work in marvelous service of humanity during the time of COVID-19, and also healthcare facilities which have taken the best steps to take care of infection prevention and control, and these may not be the highly resource enriched facilities, but some of the facilities were managing with very minimum resources, but they are taking care of the basic protocols. So that's all from my side.
Thanks, Pradeepa. It was specifically this assessment, facility improvement, HR improvements and trainings, planning, and then rewards, incentives. It's a good scheme. So I was remembering something that I was, when I was the head of the State Health Resource Center in Chhattisgarh, years back, we had a program called Enhancing Quality in Primary Healthcare called EQIP. So there were several similarities here. So I'm one question which, while in the concluding session, when concluding part, when I'm coming back to you, you may keep in mind that, how these kinds of things in a very emergency situation, in a very quick response, rapid response situation, how these can be done by the health systems is a thing that is coming to my mind. So that you may keep for, while you are responding to the, we are concluding the thing.
Yeah, so, we have, in fact, Raman, just to quickly respond, we have some working models right now, how we are responding to COVID-19 in states, and I'll be happy to share experiences from there.
Yeah.
Thanks.
All right. So Manjeet, now I'm, coming to you, specifically, WHO has developed some important tools like the WASH Fit for assessing the healthcare facilities, what is the, what situation and overall. And many countries are using this. And you have also looked at the financing patterns of, how WASH sector is financed broadly. So that also you looked at from all perspective, including health. And then you also, since you know you have experience of working in South Asian countries, and WHO of course is working in all countries across the world and at the center of all this COVID action now. So what are the kind of key experiences coming from the low and middle income countries, and what you know, how the tools and you know, systems and processes that the WHO has been you know, has developed could be used for improving the situation currently? Over to you, Manjeet.
Okay. Yeah, in terms of, I would take these two questions separately, maybe, Raman.
Okay.
I think in terms of, in terms of the tools, maybe let me kind of first come on to the tools which you kind of spoke about.
Okay.
Asad ji has already kind of mentioned about the usage of WASHFIT as an assessment tool, which was undertaken. So I think before I come on to the how part of the WASHFIT, let me kind of first talk about what WASHFIT is to, for all the participants.
Definitely. So, that'd be quite useful.
Yeah. So WASHFIT, as you are aware, and the panelists, is an adaptation of the water safety plan approach, the WSP, which is kind of recommended in the WHO guideline for drinking water quality as the most effective way of ensuring continuous provision of safe drinking water. And WSP is a kind of a continuous risk assessment approach from catchment to consumer. So it's like kind of a continuous assessment approach. So same as kind of WASHFIT takes its clue from there, and it's a risk-based continuous improvement framework with a set of tools for undertaking water and sanitation hygiene improvements as a part of the wider quality improvements in healthcare facilities. And it was designed for use in these primary healthcare facilities and maximum to the secondary facilities. And the tool aims to certainly improve the WASH and related facility management and contribute to the quality of care. And since its inception somewhere around 2015, WASHFIT has been implemented in over kind of 20 countries. And implementation efforts also have ranged in focus when it has been used for the cholera hotspots in some African countries, the post-Ebola recovery in Liberia, healthcare waste management in kind of some countries, then the duration and even the scale of it. Maybe a pilot of 3 facilities in Tajikistan, 30 facilities in 3 regions in Mali, and over 100 facilities throughout Liberia. And WASHFIT is predominantly kind of used in non-emergency settings, but it can certainly be applied in emergency settings as well. For example, it's used to conduct a rapid assessment and identify areas for improvement in 200 healthcare facilities in Cox's Bazar in Bangladesh. And if you remember, WHO and WaterAid used it for our assessment during the Kerala flood response in the Wayanad district of Kerala. It certainly has kind of use in non-emergency as well as in the emergency kind of settings. So in terms of overall WASHFIT, it's certainly a 5-step cycle, which is it's a participatory process, which with a very, very strong focus on prioritization, leadership, and kind of community engagement. And what kind of even Asad ji had mentioned in terms of the inputs, activities, and then finally the outcomes and the impact. So some of the critical inputs, or maybe I would say the main inputs, which I would maybe touch upon, would be the political, the financial, and the material, the human, and the community resources. And I think the human resource aspect was even touched by Pratibha earlier, that goes into the conducting of WASHFIT assessment and developing and implementing a facility-based kind of an action plan. And when we come to political resources, yes, political commitment, as what I think in the very initial remarks, Dr. Srivastava had mentioned, that yes, there was a political commitment in India at the highest level, starting in 2014 with Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. How it translated kind of engagement at the state and the district levels. And then support from certainly the external partners and the donors, which also facilitates the initiation and implementation of WASHFIT. And situation, and especially we kind of situating the program at the intersection of maybe WASH, IPC, the infection prevention control, the health system strengthening, and quality of care with government stakeholders also contributes to its buy-in, as there are kind of current priorities are keeping with the Sustainable Development Goals reporting process as well. So that's where it kind of also gives a kind of a cross-cutting thing as well. And supporting national government and policies, guidelines to standards within these domains certainly facilitate and the integration and institutionalization of the WASHWIT. So that's on the political resources part. In terms of the human resources, which is kind of very, very critical, facility staff, technical expertise, and the leadership skills are certainly required for the implementation. Staff participation at the facility level becomes the very key for this facility-led tool. And a strong leadership level drives the WASHWIT and becomes a very key factor in its kind of success. And in terms of the community participation, yes, community members' participation in health systems, particularly at the primary level, has certainly been recognized as an essential component in the health system strengthening and the quality of care and WASH interventions. And even if you remember, it has also been, it was highlighted in the 1978 declaration of Alma Ata. So it kind of has its genesis from there. So the WASHWIT guide certainly recommends both male and female representatives from the community, as well as any change agents or influencers which are engaged in the WASHWIT process, to be a part of it. And especially in our country, and even in many of the resource limited settings, family members or visitors often also provide care to the patients. And hence their inclusion within the WASHWIT process can also serve a dual purpose, to both increase awareness around patient and visitor safety, as well as encourage the community buy-in into the whole WASHWIT process. So in conclusion, I would say the routine use of tool coupled with the WASH infrastructure improvements, which are kind of happening and as guided by the tool in terms of while developing the facility-led plan, can lead to better IPC practices and may support improvements in occupational safety for the health workers, the quality of care, and ultimately progress towards achieving the Sustainable Development Goal 3 of good health and well-being, and also kind of for 6 of clean water and sanitation. Over.
Yeah, thanks Manjeet. So let me now go next to Dr. Srivastava. So see, doctors and nurses are at the forefront of COVID-19 response in all the healthcare facilities now. But currently urban center, but in the next thing it can go also to the rural level, if things are happening that way. So what are the key challenges that the doctors and nurses are facing in carrying out their tasks currently, specifically in a WASH constrained setting of our healthcare facility? And what all innovations are there in terms of addressing them as far as the Government of India, because I have been told by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare today that you are not only representing NHSRC today, but also the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, you are the representative. So from the ministry perspective also, how things are seen by the ministry, and also in terms of financing this, the various packages that has come in for addressing the WASH healthcare facilities, are they adequate or do we need to do more? Dr. Srivastava, can you reflect on this?
Yeah, thanks Raman, in fact, asking this timely thing. In fact, first and foremost, a challenge which came to all of us, including our frontline warriors, if I may call them, which they are, had been, in fact, first thing comes up, awareness. And awareness in the sense, awareness that it is not only at the, say, technical awareness at the functionary level, even awareness at the policy makers, at the health administrator level, because for any initiative, I'm just diverting a bit. I mean, there are three critical requirements for any initiative to succeed. One is that, traditional Donabedian model, that first thing, that structure has to be in place. When I say the structure, means that infrastructure, which in fact Dr. Sitaraman mentioned. And once then in terms of the availability of the equipments, supplies, and related stuff. Next important thing is we realized and we supported the ministry, and the gap came out in terms of the process. That how do we strengthen our process? All of us who had been somewhere connected, those who have joined our colleagues as a participants, as a panelist, Is there, I want to ask a very critical question, is there something separately are we supposed to be doing in the health facilities which were not meant to be, other than the uses of the PPE? I mean, so whether it is the waste management, whether it is the hand washing, or whether it is as simple as that, even the disposal of the liquid waste, general waste, it has been there. But our process component has been weak. Whatever the steps in the, I mean, say simple, like whole lot of media coverage is going on in the for the hand washing and uses of alcohol-based rubbed. I mean, beautifully, in fact, Manjeet and Pratibha, they belong to UN bodies, would agree. There's, and they mentioned also these guidelines and everything has been in place. But the critical challenge which came up of the process. And then secondly, like thirdly, someone mentioned, I think Manjeet or someone, that, I mean, the measurement or having a robust system of the measurement, whether in term of the, say, infection control practices or what had been the impact. So the critical challenge which came out, that at least, and which in fact I would look at the other way around, that it gave us an opportunity, that wash related thing, they were thought to be something separately, that is somebody else's job. Other clinician, I mean, though I'm a by training a clinician, but my good friends, they thought that even as simple as that, say you would recall that biomedical waste rules came in 1998, then subsequently got amended in 2016, subsequent amendments in 18 and 19. But still the surgeon operating over there or somewhere feels that this is somebody else's. So this has been in fact the one of the major gaps which came out. And then lastly, as I mentioned, the flow of the information, that how do we address. And in fact, two speakers, they mentioned about the resource. Raman, you also mentioned, Pratibha also mentioned, resource had been there. Resource is not a problem. But the problem is that how do we prioritize the resource utilization? And then how do we, link it with certain tangible quick gains, that becomes a challenge. And lastly, I would like to add, the bigger challenge for all of us is, and which is a gap also coming. First and foremost important is that, in many places, in fact, almost about 70 to 80% of the district hospitals, and maybe a bit lesser number at lower down, these services have been outsourced. Cleaning services, basically pertaining to hygiene and sanitation component. But poor contract management is another gap which is coming and hitting us again and again. Poor contract, certain obligations on the part of the contractor, and it is not that one-way traffic. All of us must have visited, but we need to do certain serious introspection that how do we ensure that all the contractual obligations from the both the parties are met. That is also a challenge. And how do we ensure that, in fact, the whatever the good practices are there, God willing, sooner or later, this COVID pandemic will get over, country will settle down. How do we sustain? This has been the challenge under Kayakalp. In fact, all the quick gains are the initiatives which have been taken because the infection, everybody realized, but the efforts needs to be sustained even if when it settles down. And resources are not a constraint. In fact, the Government of India, with the the support from Cabinet Secretariat and higher up, money is not a constraint for the state, that you, but what we need, sitting in the ministry or helping the ministry, that the state should come out with that tangible plan, which is workable, which is sustainable. And which cannot be, if I may use that term, which is not only there is some kind of shopping list, but there is a due element on the process, due element on the certain outcome indicators, that becomes important. And lastly, the big challenge for us, that is a gap also, that how do we ensure that, though COVID virus is a RNA virus, but I will say that how it becomes the DNA of the health system functioning and functioning of the public health system. So these are the certain challenges also, which we have been trying to address, and the journey is never ending. Thank you.
Thanks. So this one specific question in between one of our participants, as Kaveri Myra has raised a question also about, while the resources are not really a constraint, but there are issues about how the resources are used specifically, some discrimination happening between specific types of healthcare providers and all. It is not related mainly to WASH issues, but even in the WASH issues, how to address WASH, you know, if the resources, can they be allocated properly? Those kinds of questions are there. So while concluding, you can come to that part of it. Now I'm going to Dr. Sitaram. So Dr. Sitaram, you are in the Sri Swami Vivekananda Hospital, you are a practicing surgeon, orthopedic surgeon, and you are well versed with the various challenges of the healthcare facility setting, and you also work with district and state governments for supporting them in these areas. And SVYM, when you were the president of the SVYM, it was importantly, you have looked at some of these issues at the grassroots level. So my specific questions to you is that the inclusion and equity in the healthcare facilities that are serving the urban poor and healthcare facilities that are serving the tribal and remote locations, how constraints about the health systems constraints and also the WASH related constraints, how these could be addressed and what all are the ways for looking at it. And also in continuation to what I have asked to Dr. Srivastava, the WASH measures are protecting both healthcare providers and people. How are they doing at this point?
Yeah, thank you. A lot of points have already been covered. So though I run the risk of a bit of repetition, I'll just share some thoughts, and perhaps I'll start with the healthcare facilities in general and WASH facilities there, and the risks in the current situation of COVID-19 pandemic, and then come to the specific issue of disparity. So if we understand the general risks that exist, then we will be better able to compare and contrast the specific risks that exist in some situations. COVID-19 disease, which is caused by a coronavirus, started off primarily as a health crisis, and very, very rapidly it has snowballed into a social and an economic and a political crisis as well. So a lot of other issues have come to the fore, but it still remains a health issue, primarily a health issue. And so there is a need for a great focus on how we manage it from the health point of view, not just the medicine point of view, but the overall health point of view. So incidentally, it's interesting that you have started off this whole program of this e-conference with a focus on healthcare facilities itself. So by now, I find that interesting. I find that a very appropriate way of starting the whole discussion set as well. By now, all of us have heard about the SARS-CoV-2 virus and the disease that it causes, which is called the COVID-19, how it spreads, and all these things. The link with the healthcare facility has to be well understood. We have heard of the mechanism of spread. We have heard that it spreads by coughing, by touching and such things. And therefore, we have been focusing a lot on the importance of hand washing, the importance of social distancing. Incidentally, I don't like the term social distancing. I prefer the term physical distancing. So I've been repeatedly trying to hammer in that we need social proximity and physical distancing.
Definitely, so, yeah, that's an important thought.
So issues like cough hygiene and such things have come up. But the crux of the matter is that the world is now waking up to what we WASH activists have been crying ourselves hoarse all these years. That what protects life, what nurtures life, and what promotes health is actually basic measures around safe water, safe sanitation, and hygiene. Not necessarily the high-end gadgetries that generally are looked at as being more glamorous. So in a way, this COVID-19 crisis has brought the focus back to the basics. And it's not just in healthcare facilities alone, but in general, in all walks of life, and I do hope that this realization sustains and there will be some amount of lifestyle modification. But coming back to healthcare facilities, and like Dr. Srivatsava was mentioning, this is not something that's wholly new. It's just that the focus has now become sharper. Now, when we look at history, there have been umpteen stories of martyrs who have sacrificed their lives for betterment of mankind. And one such person that I respect immensely is a person by name Dr. Ignaz Semmelweis. I don't know how many people here have heard. This physician in Vienna in the mid 1800s noticed that the maternal mortality in the hospitals was much higher than the maternal mortality in the homes. And looked at the causes, and he realized that there was something in the hospitals, perhaps handling, which caused this increased death, and initiated this process of hand washing. Wash your hands in chlorinated lime was his focus, was his slogan. It sort of became an obsession. Unfortunately, he was probably way ahead of his time because people did not know about germ theory at that time. And his colleagues ostracized him, branded him a lunatic, and unfortunately he ended up in an asylum. You know, it's a tragic story. But the sad story tells us that if not taken care of, the healthcare facilities themselves, ironically, instead of being lifesavers, can actually become hotbeds of life-threatening infections. So this is a place where sick people visit. And so the environment is likely to be brimming with organisms which cause sickness. So this was the case in Vienna during Semmelweis' time. And though situations have changed hugely, in the COVID-19 times as well, this is how healthcare facilities pose a risk. So the first, like Pratibha was mentioning, the first priority should be do no harm. And therefore, it's very important that healthcare facilities, healthcare centers themselves gear up to these basic responsibilities and make themselves, safe. Actually, there is nothing right or wrong or mistake about it.
Dr. Sitaram, I'm getting a notification because the 6:30 next session is about to start. So they may be needing to close. I was about to extend this till 6:45, but I'm getting a notification here. Sorry, please.
Do I continue?
Yeah, please conclude.
So it's important that we collectively take up this responsibility of making the healthcare facilities safe for everybody. Everybody includes the healthcare providers who are working there, as well as the patients who visit there and the attendants who come there. You know, these are the three main categories of people who generally visit a hospital. And in order to make it safe for all these people, we need to look at it from a more holistic point of view. Like I was mentioning, while safe water being supplied to the hospital is important, it's also important to look at how the whole flow or the whole infrastructure has been planned. Now, this is where we come to the issue of disparity and inequity between different segments and centers. Now, like I was saying earlier, there are very, very small and non-decrepit small room, dingy rooms which pass off as clinics, or a small house which passes off as a nursing home. And we need to bring about better standardization and ensure better quality of enforcement here so that the wash safety is implemented in the right spirit, and not necessarily only by supplying water or only by building a toilet. It involves actually a lot of practice, and these practices are something that we need to ensure by all these segments of stakeholders. So even in the hospital, it's not just about the doctors or maybe the nurses, but the wide variety of human resource groups that exist in the healthcare facility. So everybody has to be brought on the same page, and everybody has to be practicing certain precautions and safety measures. So in the healthcare facilities, what the slogan has to be is of universal precautions, and not necessarily looking at a patient as COVID and taking special precautions about him. Because, you know, repeatedly, even in India, we have seen that a lot of asymptomatic individuals have turned SARS-CoV-2 positive. So that means the person sitting next to me, though he's not really running a fever, could well be SARS-CoV-2 positive. So I have to take precautions to make sure that he doesn't spread the disease to me or to the surroundings. So that way, it is very important that we take universal precautions at the healthcare facility level and set an example of such precautions to the rest of the community or, and everybody who visit the hospitals. One more thing that's important is within the hospital setting, there are a lot of fomites which are many times not recognized. You know, we are very fond of this 5F principles, the finger, feet, etc., etc. So fomites in the hospital, like our stethoscopes or the case sheets or the torches that we use in the hospital to examine patients, all these are potential carriers of infective material, which includes this particular virus. Many times our individual stuff like our phones or pens and such things get very easily mixed up, and we need to make sure that there is a segregation of these potentially infective fomites, and training and practice oriented towards this sort of safety has to be ensured across the board. So these are you know, streaming, separate streaming of patients who are potentially infected, adequate waiting area, ensuring that there is enough space between individuals and not much crowding, identifying potential areas of crowding and ensuring that there is some spacing out. You know, these are all essential steps that we need to plan. But when we look at the disparity that exists between what's happening in a relatively affluent urban setting versus the rural, tribal, or even in the urban settings, the crowded areas like the slums, we see that there is a huge disparity. And unless we address these challenges, the risks that these centers pose can snowball into a huge problem. That is exactly what has happened in this very pandemic in places like Italy and in the UK as well, where healthcare facilities themselves were the sites where infection started spreading to different people. So we need to take care, we need to take adequate measures to ensure that these sort of simple but very important and critical steps, which are not necessarily cost intensive, not necessarily like the ventilators that Dr. Srivatsava was mentioning, but more related to safety practices at an individual level. So if these can be actually brought about, I feel we will be taking the community towards a much safer environment today as well as for the tomorrow. So even in the rural settings, we have faced a lot of challenges, even in our tribal hospital, to bring these practices in, put these practices in place. But you know, we are happy to say that in that very hospital, we have now been able to bring in all these measures. People over a period of time and with appropriate guidance, appropriate training, and appropriate example setting, which is extremely important, people will accept wearing masks, staying distant, not touching things unnecessarily, hand hygiene, etc. So we have seen that happen. So the doctors and the healthcare facilities need to lead this change in the community. So when it comes from the mouth of people whom the community reveres, there is additional weight that the words carry. So it's not only the responsibility to treat a patient, but also ensure appropriate behavioral change.
All right. So I'm sorry to you know, close, because you know the next session they are about to start, so we need to close the session now, and I cannot even go back to, there are some critical questions that I had listed. I was about to come back to all of you because, you know, we have 10 more minutes to go as per the timing of the session, but because of technically the next session has to start, so I will have to close here. So I have requested Asad, you have a question on the chat, you know, QA section, please type in the response from your side. And similarly, Dr. Srivastava, if you can, you know, type in that specifically about the discrimination question, if you want to. So that is one thing. And finally, if you look at, you know, we have come up with several important issues during this session. We have highlighted a lot of very critical kind of things that currently what is happening. And since COVID is happening in a time when we are almost 10 years, 10 years of time is there for the SDG. So how the SDGs related to Washington healthcare facility could be achieved? Thinking, and keeping this as an opportunity is a question that I wanted all of you to respond. But at this point, there are continuously, alerts are coming from the organizers that we cannot go for that. So that is something with that thought, probably we will have to close. And there are very, very interesting and important thoughts that has come about how, in this pandemic has taught us about, or it highlighted the importance of Washington healthcare facilities and, gave us ways for improving it. And, how resources were, otherwise difficult resources were pooled in for Washington healthcare facilities and related issues. That also is something that we are seeing, but there are inadequacies about it. So how, taking learnings from all of this, our typical mixed health systems like that of India is learning from this and, focusing the, investments on these most needy areas and going to do well. And not only going to do well for the pandemic, but also to take it forward towards, the sustainable development goal is a question that we may all need to collectively answer, not necessarily now, but through our actions and our ongoing discussions. And I thank all my esteemed and expert panelists who responded to some of these questions and, and all the participants who were there and the team that supported this entire thing. So little difficulty about timing was there. So I had kept a question for Manjeet. I had kept one question for Dr. Srivastava and all of you actually. So those questions I'm not able to raise now. So thanks a lot for joining us this evening. And definitely with this collective wisdom and collective action, we'll be able to contribute to the march towards fulfilling safely. The improved improving the Washington healthcare facility situation. Thank you all participants.